So today I want to preach pretty much in depth and go through James chapter 2, just the second half of James chapter 2, particularly talking about, you know, faith without works is dead. Because, you know, when you go out soul winning, you talk to people that believe salvation, it's a key passage that people try and use to defend work salvation or to defend an assurance of salvation by works. So I want to go through it in depth tonight and give you everything that I know about James 2. And I think at the end of this sermon, you'll see that it's a pretty indefensible position for people to use James 2 in regards to salvation. So let's just start off by reading that portion of the chapter, which starts down here in verse 14. James 2. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, Depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, Thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Likewise also, was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So I hope tonight really helps you in your witnessing and when you're going out there and preaching the gospel, because I find I talk about this chapter a lot. And especially when it comes to the cults, when it comes to the Mormons, the Jehovah's Witnesses, sometimes you'll come across people that go to like pretty decent Christian churches and they might be saved, but they have some confusion because they've just heard it their whole life. Faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. If I don't have the works, then my faith isn't genuine, and so on and so forth. So what do people really say what this passage means before we go into what it actually means? Some things they say is they'll just preach like a blatant work salvation, and then they'll just say, see, Abraham was justified by works. And we know, and that really is not a hard position to argue against, because the Bible's so clear, you know, Ephesians 2:8, for by grace he saved through faith. You guys know all these verses, the guys in this room. You know, Romans 4, Ephesians 2, I won't go to all these verses just for sake of time. You know, Titus 3:5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. The Bible's so clear that salvation is not by works. So for somebody to just take James and not take any of the other Bible into account is pretty hard to defend. And one tip I can give you, if you are in a conversation with somebody that has this position with James or has a wrong position in James, and you take them to a passage to counter that position, one method I use is rather than first taking the time to explain James to them, I throw it on them first. I find if you can go on the attack first and make them defend, then that I think that puts them in a worse position than when you are trying to explain things and not being able to show them the verses that would counteract their position. So say you're out talking and somebody brings you to James 2, rather than, you know, re-preaching this sermon to them and going all through the points I'm going to talk to you about tonight, my tactic first would be I would take them to Ephesians 2, I would take them to Romans 4 and read that with them, and then say, well, what do you think that means with your interpretation of James? If you say James means this, how would you understand Romans 4? And then that usually makes them think, because when you read Romans 4, you know, it says, you know, without works, then they need to think, oh, how will what I think about James 2 line up with that? And then start from a position of, I feel, strength, and then bring it back to James 2. When they can't explain it, then you give them an explanation. So that has been pretty effective for me. So hopefully that helps you. So that's a tip there. when you know when you're trying to do these things is rather than just trying to explain the verse to them, that you take them to a verse to counteract it and see if they can explain that clear verse to you first, and then go back and explain James 2 if you have time. So they might say, you know, just blatant work salvation. They might say, oh, you know, faith and works are inseparable. You know, they'll say something like that. You know, if you have faith, you'll always have works. But, you know, how would that make sense? Because how would it even then be possible to ever have a dead faith? Do you know? If faith and works are inseparable, if you have faith, you always have works, then how can you even ever have, how can faith ever be dead if it always is accompanied by works? Right? So they're not inseparable. And they wouldn't even agree. They might say, well, you know, they will always believe that faith can exist without works, right? Because even in the chapter itself, when it talks about the devil's believing, because, you know, when you say to somebody, oh, you know, well, you can believe and not have works, and they say, oh, faith without works is dead. And if they say something like, well, faith and works are inseparable, but generally those same people will say, well, but the devils believe and they're not saved, when you say, well, you can believe and not have works. So if the devils believe, see, it's possible for somebody to believe something and not have works because the devils believe and they don't have good works. So faith and works being inseparable, I don't think is a defensible position because, you know, and we'll go to Romans 4 a bit later in the sermon, but if they are inseparable and faith always accompanies works, how can somebody ever have a dead faith? Number three might be they'll say, you know, we're not saved by faith and works, but we're saved by faith that works, right? They'll say something like that. They'll say, well, you don't have to do faith and works, but if you have, it's faith that works. See, to me, that's just another way of saying faith and works, because if it's faith that works, then by definition, they'll say, if you don't have works, then you don't have faith. So the faith and the works will always need to be there, otherwise you're not saved. Because both are still required in their eyes. So unless they think, you know, works are automatic, in which case, you know, why would we be exhorted to not sin if once you had faith, you would always work? Right? So again, I think when somebody says it's not faith and works, but faith that works, is really just saying the same thing. They're saying you need works, otherwise you are not saved. Another thing people might say is, you know, works are not required for salvation. So they'll say it's not works that is needed for salvation, but there needs to be some change. Right? There needs to be some change. But, you know, my question to that is, well, then why then isn't a change in faith enough? You know, if somebody says, well, it doesn't take works to get saved, but if you believe, there must be some change. Why isn't the fact that their faith has changed enough change to make it change? Because really, when you think about the phrase, faith without works is dead, and if somebody makes that phrase mean, well, you're not saved without works, then the next logical question is, well, how much works do I need before my faith is alive in order to be saved according to that definition? Like, what arbitrary amount of works are they assigning to this works, pseudo-works salvation in order for somebody to know that they're saved or in order to be able to say, I am saved? And if it's arbitrary, why isn't, you know, one attendance at church enough? But that's not enough for them, because if somebody goes to church and then quits, faith without works is dead, right? But then they did have a work, but it's still not enough for them. So they don't really apply it consistently, I find. So that's some of the things that people say. But let's go through James 2, 14 to 26, to the end. And see exactly what James 2 is talking about. So let's start at verse 14. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? So three questions straight up when we read verse 14. The first one is, it says, what doth it profit? Now, is this profit talking about profit to the person believing, or is it talking about profit to other people? Right, because it doesn't say, you know, who is it profiting? It doesn't say, will it profit you, my brethren? Like, well, will it profit thou, my brother, if you have faith? It's just saying, what doth it profit? So who is it profiting? That's one thing to think about. Second thing is when it says here, though a man say he hath faith and have not works. So is the verse even saying here that a man has faith and doesn't have works? No, it's just saying a man says he has faith, right? And the reason why I believe James is quite clear to make the statement a man says he has faith and has not works, as opposed to a man has faith and doesn't have works, because as we'll see in the rest of the chapter, this chapter is about your faith in the eyes of other men. And that's all you can really see when somebody says they have faith. I mean, you don't know whether they really have faith, but you do know that they say they have faith, right? Because you're hearing the words that they say. So though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? So one thing about this last passage of can faith save him, number one, it's a question. It doesn't say faith can't save him or faith can save him. It's not a statement. It's just a question. But also you've got to ask the question, is the saving that it's talking about, is it a physical saving or is it a spiritual saving? Is it talking about salvation spiritually from our sins, or is it talking about a physical salvation, meaning like if somebody just says he has faith and doesn't have works, is that going to help his physical life at all? Well, let's go on to verse 15. So those are three things to think about. Just first up in verse 14. Now, my position, obviously, you guys know, is, you know, James 2 is talking about your faith in the eyes of men, not in the eyes of God. It's not talking about spiritual salvation. And I think when we go on to verse 15, we can see that this position is supported by what is then taught in the next couple of verses. It says here in verse 15, if a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? So two things here. In verse 15, when it says a brother or sister be naked, so what do we think of? They don't have any clothing, right? And destitute of daily food. One thing that's interesting here is if we compare this to Matthew 6 and go to verse 31, these are our two basic necessities, right? These are the two things that if we don't have, that we would probably die. You know, if we didn't have a way to clothe ourselves and be sheltered from the heat or from the warmth, or if we didn't have any food. Verse 31 here in Matthew 6, therefore take no thought saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or wherewithal shall we be clothed? So you see that food and raiment. For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that he have need of all these things. So it's not want, it's not a desire of these things. These are a basic necessity. So we go back to James 2, and we remember we were thinking about this, hey, you know, what does the prophet, first of all, man says he has faith. We don't really know whether he does have faith. We are just, you know, hearing that he's telling us that he has faith. Can faith save him? So I believe the saving is talking about a physical salvation, because if it goes on to verse 15 and 16, talking about the physical needs of somebody else, that would be consistent. So we're talking about the needs of the food and the raiment. Now look at how verse 16 ends, right? So 16 says, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body. So he's saying, hey, you're just wishing them well, but not actually helping them. Look at how it ends. What doth it profit? So what is the profit in verse 16? Is the profit to yourself? Or is it the profit to somebody else? In verse 16, it's your faith profiting somebody else, because he's saying if you have the faith and you just say, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, and you don't give them anything that is needful to the body, what doth it profit? So isn't that then consistent with verse 14 when it says, what doth it profit, my brethren? It's talking about the profit to other people as opposed to the profit to yourself. What your faith does to other people if it has works, as opposed to not having works. All right, let's go on to verse 17. It says here, even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Now, this is the one that everyone goes to. This is what they know, right? Faith without works is dead. So let's think about some things with verse 17. Number one is, what is dead when there is no works? It's the faith that's dead, isn't it? Does it say that the person is dead without works? No. So it's faith without works is dead, not believer is dead without works. Faith, even so faith, if it hath not... Oh, if the believer without works is dead. Just trying to make it line up there. So it's not saying the believer is dead, right? It's saying that the faith is dead, not the person. Now, what does it mean? What does dead mean? Does dead mean non-existent? Does dead mean genuine? No, not genuine? Dead just means it's not alive, right? I'll show you this passage here in Romans 4:19, how the word dead is used in regards to Sarah and Abraham. It says here, "And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb." So something that is dead can mean that it doesn't bring forth life. And that's what a dead faith will do. If you have faith and you don't have works, you're not going to bring forth life, right? You think about it. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. So if you don't have works with your faith is not going to profit anybody else. It's not going to bring forth new life. You are alive. Your faith is dead, though. And if you have dead faith, it's not going to bring forth life. Just like it's saying here, Abraham could not have a child. His body was now dead. Right? It wasn't bringing forth any life. Remember, they were barren. They couldn't have children. It's not that Abraham didn't exist. Abraham existed, but he was dead. Same with the deadness of Sarah's womb. Sarah had a womb, but it was dead because it was barren. It couldn't bring forth life. And that's what a faith without works is. It is dead. Now, there are two types of faith. Right? Like people say, like, oh, you know, there isn't different types of faith. I mean, there is. Because, I mean, if faith without works is dead, the opposite is a living faith. So there are different types of faith, right? You either faith is either dead or it's alive. Kind of like how you're either walking in the spirit or walking in the flesh. You can go between these two, where you have a dead faith when you're walking in the flesh, and you have a living faith when you're walking in the spirit. So they sort of, switch back and forth because you have those two natures. So there are two faiths. It's not like there is faith, right? But it can be alive or dead. That means it can be profitable to other people or not profitable to other people. Let's see if I missed anything here. So, yeah, there can be two types of faith, and that is based on works, right? Whether your faith is alive or whether it's dead is based on works, but not whether it is existent. Now, let's go to verse 18. It says here, "Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works." So a couple of things to note about this verse is, one thing is, James is not saying this is how I show my faith to other people, right? What is he saying here? He's saying a man may say, and then he goes on. So number one, it's not even saying James is saying, hey, this is what I do or this is what you should do. He's just saying, hey, somebody might say this because if you want to show your faith to somebody else, you would want to do works. You'd say, hey, I believe this. And when you do it, it's showing them that you actually believe it. So it says here, "A man may say, thou hast faith and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works." So he's saying, how am I going to see your faith without works? But I can show you my faith by my works. I can show you what I believe by my works. So again, you see the theme through James 2. It's about other people seeing your faith, right? He's saying, hey, I can't see your faith without works, but I'm going to show you my faith by my works. See, it's nothing between man and God. This is about man and man. Man showing man seeing man's faith by their works. And notice, remember verse 14, remember when it said here, "What doth it profit my brethren, though man say he hath faith?" So he's just saying he has faith, right? Because that's what this chapter is about. It's about seeing other people's faith. And because you can't see their heart, you can hear what they say. It's using that hypothetical of if someone says they have faith. Well, it's the same thing in verse 18. "Yea, a man may say," right? This is what people say, right? "Thou hast faith and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works." I mean, we don't even know if this man actually has faith. You know, he might be just saying, hey, I'm going to show you my faith by my works, but we don't know whether he's saved. James doesn't say anything about whether he's saved or not. It's just the fact that people can't see your faith, and this is how you show your faith to other people. So again, we are only addressing what is visible by man, not God. And we're not told for certain that this man has faith, only that he says he has faith. Let's go on to verse 19. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. Now, what is this verse saying? This verse is saying that the devils believe there is one God, right? Because he says, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. So it's good to believe that there's only one God as opposed to multiple gods like some religions teach. And he's saying the devils also believe. So what are they believing? They're believing that there is one God. And they tremble. They tremble because they do fear the Lord, knowing what the Lord can do to them. Just like when Jesus came, you know, the man possessed with devils, and he's like, what have I to do with thee, Jesus? Right? Because he was scared, and they wanted to go into the herd of swine. I have some thoughts on that, but I won't go into that for the sake of time. So the verse is not saying, verse 19 is not saying that the devils believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And so many people say that, right? When you say, hey, well, somebody might believe on Jesus Christ and they don't have works, and they'll say, oh, the devils believe and they're not saved, they tremble. Yeah, but the Bible's not saying that the devils believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's just saying that the devils believe there is one God. So first of all, that's not what that verse is saying. It's only saying that they believe there is one God. Now, even if angels did believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, can they be saved? No. Why is that? Because Jesus Christ, number one, did not die for angels, and he didn't take on the nature of angels. And we are actually told that in Hebrews 2. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily, truly, he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. So Christ took on flesh and blood in order to die for mankind. Now, I do believe angels can sort of become flesh and blood somehow. I don't know whether they have blood, but whether they have flesh. I think that is possible, my view. But they have their own nature. There is a nature of angels. So if angels sin, unless somebody takes on the nature of angels to be the sacrifice for angels, angels do not have a savior. And that's why when they sin against God, that's it for them. They go to hell for that one disobedience. But we have a savior, thank God. So angels do not have a savior because Christ only took on the seed of Abraham. He didn't take on the nature of angels. So even if angels believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, they would not be saved from their sin. They do not have a savior like man does. Let's go on to verse 20. So thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. So again, he's drilling this point home that your faith is not profitable to other people. Your faith is dead. It's not alive. It's not bringing forth life. And that's why he says, O vain man. Wilt thou know, O vain man? Because what's the opposite of being profitable? It's vanity. Okay, let's go on to verse 21. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only, and not by faith only. So we already sort of talked about verse 24, but let's go through this a bit more in depth. Now, first point I want to make is in verse 22, it says here, seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. So even here, if somebody tries to say, well, you know, if you don't have works, you don't have faith, but the Bible doesn't say here that by works your faith is made genuine or your faith is made existent, is it? It's saying here that his faith was made perfect. Now, how do you make something that doesn't already exist perfect, right? So the faith already existed, and that's why when Abraham added works to his faith became perfect or it became complete. It doesn't say that it became genuine or it became that it existed, now existed because he had works, because, you know, they'll say, well, if you don't have works, then you don't really have the faith. Whereas this is saying, well, the works made the faith that existed perfect. A couple other things to note here. Look at verse 22. Look at how it starts. Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. So I just want you to know those two words there. Seest thou. And it says here, and the scripture was fulfilled, which saith Abraham believed God and was imputed unto him for righteousness. Now let me ask you, if nobody ever saw a prophecy in the scripture being fulfilled, how would they ever know it was fulfilled? See, that's why Jesus, he fulfilled scripture by actually not doing, like we read today in Acts, these things were not done in a corner. People saw, people knew that he was born in Bethlehem. People saw that he was crucified, that he was bruised and beaten. A lot of the things that he did to fulfill the Old Testament scriptures, how he died, you know, according to the scriptures and rose again the third day, according to the scriptures, they're fulfilled because they're seen of men. Right? If God just sees it fulfilled, God already knows they're going to get fulfilled, right? But man sees the scripture being fulfilled. And that's how they know that the scripture is more trustworthy. Look at verse 24. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. So this lines up with the theme of James 2. The theme of James 2 being that it is your faith in the eyes of other people. How you show your faith to other people, how other people see your faith. And it's saying here a couple of times, hey, you see. It's not saying that, hey, you know, faith was made perfect. Faith is made perfect by works. It's saying here, you see faith being made perfect by works. That's the point it's making there. It's saying the scripture was fulfilled. And then it's saying here, you see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. So it's not saying that a man is justified by works and faith in the eyes of God. It's saying, hey, you see somebody's faith justified in your eyes because of their works. Okay, now I want to go into Abraham because this is really probably the biggest way to really debunk this idea that you need works in order to make your faith genuine that saves you. Now, Abraham is really the big example in James 2 to say, hey, Abraham is this example of being justified by works and not by faith only. But when we look at actually Abraham's life and his example and what is actually being said here, we see here that Abraham's example is actually proving the opposite of that view, that faith and works is required for salvation or is required to have a genuine faith. But it's actually this example in James 2 is actually teaching the opposite. So let's go into that. So look at verse 21. Verse 21 says here, was not Abraham our father justified by works? And they might just stop there and say, see, Abraham was justified by works. But that's not the end of the verse, because the verse actually tells us how Abraham was justified by works. It said, when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar. Now that is a key phrase on why Abraham is being used as an example in James 2. And that is your faith in the eyes of men, the scripture being fulfilled, people seeing Abraham's faith. When did they see Abraham's faith? When he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar. Now if we go back, and we're going to do that, we're going to look at all these verses, we're going to go back into Abraham's life and we're going to see when he offered Isaac his son upon the altar, as opposed to when he got saved. And the way we're going to do that is, first of all, we're going to compare Romans 4. And this is what I do when I talk to people out soul winning about James 2, is I explain to them Romans 4 and go through this and then show them that how they're interpreting James 2 cannot be correct. Let's read through Romans 4, 1 to 11. What shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. So Romans 4 and James 2 is a perfect comparison because it's using the same scriptures, right? Using the same person, Abraham, and it's using the same scripture that he believed God and was counted unto him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace but of debt, but to him that worketh not but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. Let's just stop there for a moment. So we can see here that we are using the same example, Abraham. And it says here, hey, what shall we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham were justified by works, and this is why it's a perfect comparison with James 2, because James 2 is saying, well, Abraham was justified by works. Romans 4 is making the same statement. If Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory. So he has honor, but where is that honor and that glory? It's before man. Why? Not before God. So Abraham, if he's justified by works, he can glory before men, which is what we're talking about. James 2 is in the eyes of men. But when it comes to the eyes of God, because God can see his faith, God, Abraham is not justified by works in the eyes of God. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God and it was counted unto him for righteousness. So you see here, it's not talking about the scripture being fulfilled. It's just saying that this is what the scripture says. He's just saying Abraham is justified by his faith and not by works. But in James 2, it says you see the scripture fulfilled that says Abraham believed God and imputed unto him for righteousness. You see how it's different, how James 2 and Romans 4 are talking about the same passages. And these are the ones we're very familiar with. To him that worketh, now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. You see, because it's a debt. If something is owed to you, it can't be a gift. If somebody owes something to you, a gift is something that is given that is not owed to you. But to him that worketh not. So we see here, no works at all, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly. His faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. So that's a really hard one for them to explain. If they're going to say, well, you need works with your faith, and you take them to Romans 4 and say, well, this is a dead faith. This is somebody that has a dead faith. They do not work. They believe. But they have the blessedness and the imputed righteousness to them without works, in verse 6. Saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. So you see, when we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we not only do not have sin imputed to us, but we have righteousness imputed to us from the Lord Jesus Christ. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision? So the blessedness is the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. So it's saying here, hey, this blessedness of being having your not sin imputed to you, but having righteousness imputed to you, how was it then reckoned? Well, it says that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. So it wasn't by works. How was it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had, yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that the righteousness might be imputed unto them also. We'll stop there. So this is where Romans 4, and we're going to look at some of the Old Testament passages that prove this. Romans 4 is teaching that Abraham, when he was justified by faith, he was not even yet circumcised yet when he was justified by faith. Because it says, how was it then reckoned to him? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. And the next verse describes that he received the sign of circumcision, a sign of the faith that he already had while he wasn't circumcised. Now, what did James 2 teach? James 2, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? So we have two timestamps here where we can go back to the Old Testament and we can compare, hey, when did Abraham receive the sign of circumcision? When did he actually get saved? As opposed to when did he offer Isaac his son on the altar. And we'll go to these verses really quickly, and I'll show you how these two time periods, Romans 4 and James 2, are decades apart. Let's first of all go to Genesis 12, and this is where Abraham is called out of his country to go to a country that he didn't know. It says here, "Now the Lord hath said unto Abraham," so this is Genesis 12, "Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. So take note of that. How old is he when he gets called and departs out of Haran? He's 75 years old. "And Abraham took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came. And Abraham passed through the land unto the place of Sychem, unto the plain of Moreh, and the Canaanite was then in the land. And the Lord appeared unto Abraham, and said, Unto thy seed will I give this land, and there builded he an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. And he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he builded an altar unto the Lord," and here we go, "and called upon the name of the Lord." You know, so it's interesting that, you know, in John, I think it's 6 off the top of my head, but, you know, Jesus said, you know, no man can come to me unless the Father draw him. So there is a calling or a drawing from God, but it's just that everyone, we believe, is drawn and called in order to be saved. You know, many are called, but few are chosen, because many are called unto salvation. You know, the Spirit and the bride say, come, but not everybody does heed the call and believes on Jesus Christ. So here I believe we are reading the salvation of Abraham. And other people might say, well, he was saved later. That's not really going to matter if you compare it with James 2. But I believe this is where he's saved, because whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Goes well with verse 8 here, where he builds an altar and calls upon the name of the Lord. And it's just interesting that there's that picture there, that in the New Testament we learn that, you know, the Father draws, and that's why people can come to him. And Abraham having that picture of the Lord calling him first, and then he responds by calling upon the name of the Lord and getting saved. So let's then go to Genesis 15. So remember, that's where he got saved. That's where I believe he got saved. And how old was he when he left Haran? 75 years old. Let's go to Genesis 15. Genesis 15, we'll read verses 1 to 6. "After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision, saying, Fear not, Abraham, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abraham said, Lord God, what would thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abraham said, Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad, and said, Look now toward heaven, and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, So shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness." I believe "so shall thy seed be" is a reference in Galatians 3 as well, as he preached the gospel to Abraham. If off the top of my head, I don't have that in my notes. But here is where, you know, God is promising him that he is going to be, he's going to have this exceeding seed. But Abraham says to him, "But I don't have a child." And that's where he goes out and says, "Hey, see if you can count the stars. That's what your seed is going to be like." And this is where we get the scripture: Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. You know, in James 2, it said Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. This is where Abraham believed the Lord, and it was counted to him for righteousness. So some people might say, "Well, was he saved when he was 75, when he called upon the name of the Lord, or was he saved here?" People can debate the two, but I think here is where God is making him the father of many nations, you know, as we read in Romans 4, that he might be the father of all them that believe, because he said to him, "Hey, you're going to have a child, as much as the sand is as the sea and the stars in heaven," and Abraham believed that. That's what made him the father of faith and the father of many nations, as opposed to his own salvation, which was in Genesis 12. That's what I believe. So it was counted to him for righteousness, and it was that righteousness that was counted to him in Genesis 6 that is then used as an example of salvation in the New Testament, is what made Abraham the father of faith and the father of many nations, as described in Romans 4 and Galatians 3. Now let's go to Genesis 16, the next chapter. 15. And we see here in Genesis 16, if you remember the story of Abraham, that Sarah, it seems that Sarah did not actually believe that promise. And she thought, hey, maybe what God meant by giving you a lot of seed, that you would sleep with my servant Hagar and have a child by Hagar. And if Hagar gives birth by leaning over my knee, you know, that would be my child. And you know, people start thinking crazy things when they get out of the will of God. They get away from the word of God. They come up with these weird theories, don't they? So in Genesis 16, verse 15, it says here, and Hagar bare Abraham a son, and Abraham called his son's name, which Hagar bare, Ishmael. And Abraham was 86 years old when Hagar bare Ishmael to Abraham. So how old was Abraham when he got saved? 75. How old was he when he gave birth, or when Hagar gave birth to Ishmael? He was 86 years old. A score is 20 years. Four times 20 is 80, plus the 6 years, 86 years old. Now let's go to Genesis 17. Genesis 17, 24 and 25. We see here the age when Abraham is actually given the sign of circumcision. It says here, Abraham was 90 years old and 9. So 99 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. If you read the whole chapter, you'll see before he talks to God and God says, hey, this is going to be a sign between you and me. Forever, you know, that prophesying of the circumcision without hands in Jesus Christ. When he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin, and Ishmael his son was 13 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. So remember, if you remember back to Romans 4, when he says, when was Abraham justified by faith? Was it when he was circumcised or when he was uncircumcised? Remember, was it when he was uncircumcised? We even see that in the Old Testament. So we can cross-reference Romans 4, make sure Paul is, you know, writing the same thing that he is, because Abraham was justified by, was counted unto him for righteousness in Genesis 16, and then in Genesis 15, then Ishmael is born in Genesis 16, then in Genesis 17, he is then given the sign of circumcision, and he is now 99 years old. So almost 25 years later, he is given the sign of circumcision after he is saved. So I hope you're starting to see here, James 2 cannot mean that it was Abraham's salvation by his works. Let's go to Genesis 21. We're going to see more ages of Abraham. Genesis 21:5, and Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born unto him. So God has promised him seed. He's given him the sign of circumcision. Ishmael is now born. You know, Ishmael is born. He's given the sign of circumcision. And Isaac is still not born, even when he's given the sign of circumcision that he believed God about later on before in Genesis 15. Now it's not till Genesis 21, 1 year later, when Abraham is 100 years old, that Isaac is now born. So 25 years after he was saved, he now has Isaac, his son, at 100 years old. Now let's go to Genesis 22. Genesis 22, it's the first two verses. We'll just read the first two verses. And if you read the rest of the chapter, it's the story about him actually taking Isaac, his son, up to mount the mountain to offer him to God. And you know, it's interesting that even in Genesis 22, we won't go there, but Abraham knew that God was going to raise up. Well, Abraham knew that he was going to sacrifice his son and somehow he was going to get his son back. Because I don't know if I can find it. It's not in my notes, but when he goes up to the mountain, right, he leaves his servants behind. I don't know if those of you are familiar with the story. And he says, hey, I and the lad will go yonder and worship and will return to you again. So he knows that he's coming back with Isaac. It's just that Abraham thought that he was going to sacrifice Isaac, right? Acting out the gospel that Jesus Christ would be sacrificed for his sins. But he believed that even though he sacrificed Isaac, his son, that God would raise him up from the dead. Because he knew that Isaac obviously had to, because remember, Isaac didn't have children until many years later as well, because his wife Rebekah was barren. It wasn't until he was like 60 years old that he had children. So Abraham believed God, remember? Abraham believed God that he was going to have seed through Isaac. So he knew, hey, God's not going to tell me to kill Isaac if Isaac is the promised seed and he's going to be the father of many nations. So he believed that if he was going to kill Isaac, that God would then raise up Isaac from the dead, which we learn, I believe, in Hebrews. I don't have that in my notes. Accounting that God was even raised him up from the dead, right? From whence he received him as a figure. But what he didn't realize is that he would not put Abraham through that to actually kill his son. And then he sacrificed a ram instead of his son Isaac. So in verse 20, chapter 22 is where God then tells Abraham and tests him, right? He tests him, which is how the Bible can use the word tempt. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here am I, here I am. And he said, take now thine son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest. And this is interesting that the first mention of the word love in the Bible is a father giving his son in sacrifice. Isn't that an interesting thing? That, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And the first mention of the word love in the King James Bible is the example of Abraham being told, hey, go and offer your son on the altar, the son that you love, and get thee into the land of Moriah and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And then it goes on into Abraham actually going and carrying out that task. So let's now look at, so think about this. If we go back to James 2, so remember the dates. Abraham was 75 when he called upon the name of the Lord, 100 when Isaac was born. But how old was Abraham when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You know, I can't remember. Oh, actually, one thing I should have looked up is how old Abraham was when he died, because obviously he had to be before that. I can't remember exactly. I think it's like 100. I don't know whether it was like 190-something. Does everyone know off the top of their head how old Abraham was? I think it's like 190-something. But I don't know. So he's 100 when he gave birth to Isaac. But how old was he when he went and offered Isaac on the altar? Right? So we go back to James. Let's go to James 2. Because we remember here. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? So is James 2 teaching that Abraham was justified salvation-wise by his works? No, because Romans 4 says he was justified before he was even circumcised. And here it's saying that he was justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar. So if he's 75 when he got saved, he's 100 when he gave birth to Isaac. And if you remember the story of him taking Isaac up to the mountain, remember Isaac had to actually carry the wood on his back and traverse the mountain, right? So he's not taking like a 5-year-old or a 10-year-old up with him to the mountain, because if you were to take like a 10-year-old, like say Kevin was to take Nicholas up a mountain, I mean, Nicholas is not going to last that hike up the mountain, let alone carrying all the wood for the sacrifice up there with him. Right, so Isaac obviously is a young man. He's an adult, right, in order to do this task. So let's say he's maybe at least 15, 20 years old. So let's say Abraham is 120 when he offers Isaac his son upon the altar, as opposed to before he was circumcised, when he was given this, he circumcised Ishmael when Ishmael was 13 and he was 86. So that's already, what's that, 34 years? But if you say he was saved when he was 75, so that's 25 plus maybe 20, so 45 years, almost half a decade before he offered Isaac his son upon the altar, and people are going to use James 2 to prove that Abraham was justified salvation-wise by his works. Of course, that's not what it's teaching. And it fits with the whole theme of James 2 James 2 in this passage, which is, remember, our faith profiting another person. It's our faith being seen by other people. And it's saying here, this is how Abraham's faith was seen by other people when he actually did that task and was willing to go sacrifice his son on the altar. Because think about all the other promises, right? The other promises, the promise before was things that nobody else saw. You know, like when he promised him that he would be the father of many nations, that was just between God and Abraham, wasn't it? When it was counted to him for righteousness, God came to him and said, look at the stars. And he says, so shall thy seed be. And then he believed God, but nobody saw that faith. But they saw that faith that he was going to be the father of many nations because he took his only son, the promised son, and was willing to kill him, right? Knowing or believing that God was going to raise him up from the dead, right? So that's what justified his faith. That's what showed his faith to other people because he was willing to do that to show that, hey, God will either raise him up from the dead or do something. Otherwise, you know, how is God going to fulfill his promise that Isaac was going to be the father of many nations as well? So this is proof that James 2 is not about salvation because Abraham was saved decades, you know, almost half a century, I believe, before he offered Isaac his son upon the altar. And that is a really powerful point when if you have the time to explain that to somebody and compare Romans 4, I mean, you don't have to go to all the Old Testament passages, but just explaining Romans 4 and just saying, hey, you know, Abraham, it's saying here that Abraham was justified by his faith before he was even circumcised. And that was many, many years later, many, many years before he offered his son Isaac upon the altar. James 2 cannot be talking about Abraham's salvation, as well as all the other points that I brought up. Now let's finish off with Rahab the harlot, because again, you know, there are two examples in James 2 to say that, you know, faith without works is dead, and that if you have works with your faith, then it would make your faith perfect. And this is how people see it in the eyes. People see your faith. Other people see your faith, how your faith is seen in the eyes of other men. So the other example to Abraham is Rahab. And we won't spend so much time in Rahab, but we will go to the Old Testament passage because I want to show you that both these examples, everyone uses Abraham as an example, and that's a strong enough example to prove that James 2 is not talking about salvation by works. But I want to show you that even Rahab's example is an example also to show you that salvation is not justified by works, but by faith. So it says here in verse 25, likewise also was not Rahab the harlot. Now let's just stop there. I mean, that first of all should show you that, you know, that we, you know, it's not saying that you need works in order to have faith or you need works in order to be saved. Because he's calling Rahab here the harlot. Right now, you're going to give, like, nobody's going to, like, point to somebody as an example of, hey, this is somebody where, hey, they've got that living faith, that saving faith, where they didn't just make an empty profession, you know, they professed and they were in church, but, you know, they're just a prostitute, you know. Oh, that's the only thing that they've got wrong is that they go out and they're paid by men to sleep with them. Nobody's going to use a prostitute as an example of like an ideal church member and say, hey, look, this is how you really go soul winning, right? And the people have these fruit that abounds. So you're not going to use Rahab the harlot, first of all, as an example of having good works, right? Because she's doing one of the most wicked things you can do, which is, fornicate with people just for money. And you know what? Fornicating with people without money is worse than what Rahab is doing. And that's what the Bible teaches in the Old Testament, because, you know, it says in the Old Testament that at least a prostitute is getting paid, you know, to sleep with people. But then people that just date people and just sleep with them, you know, a guy takes you out for dinner and you're willing to jump in the sack with him, the Bible says that you're worse than a prostitute, because at least a prostitute gets paid. But the person that just fornicates with people and doesn't get paid, you know, they're even worse than a prostitute. Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way. So let's go to just a couple other things I just want to point out here. Again, it says here in verse 25, likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works. So if we understand the example of Abraham, which is that he wasn't justified in his salvation by works, remember, because he was saved many years before, we already know from James that Rahab's not going to be an example because, number one, she's a harlot, and number two, it says likewise. So her example is going to be like Abraham's, which was not an example of him being justified by works in terms of salvation. Now let's go to the actual passage in Joshua. And it's Joshua 2, where we read the story of Rahab. And I want to show you that even from the Old Testament passage of Rahab, we see that she was saved before she received the messengers and sent them out another way. Now, one thing that's really, you know, I'm making these children's, trying to make these children's books from those cartoons that I have. And I found this really cool one, actually, and that's the one I'm working on right now. And the cartoon is about Hebrews 11. So I've made the crossing of the Red Sea so far. I've showed Kevin and a couple of you guys here. And I just find it really cool because I find it so hard to find good Bible books for kids that don't like sort of water things down. And I find the images in these cartoons are pretty good, like they're pretty accurate. You know, for example, like even the cartoon about Elijah and the prophets of Baal, it because it's going through the passage and reading through the contemporary English version, it does mention how the prophets were slain, you know, and it doesn't show them getting killed, but it shows like a river and just, you know, a red river and blood going through the river. So I've done a Moses, the crossing of the Red Sea so far, and I find it's just really cool because if I read the Bible to my kids, rather than just reading them a paraphrased, you know, picture book about David and Goliath, or a picture book about the crossing of the Red Sea, and it's paraphrased it all, you know, why not just read them the Bible passages, you know, and then you read them the story, you don't miss anything out, and at the same time, they're learning the scriptures. So I hope to make a few more, and hope that'll be a blessing to, like, parents as they can read the Bible to their kids, because I find, you know, if I just read them the words, yes, they'll pick up some of it. Yes, it teaches them just to learn to sit and listen to the Bible reading, but they don't really get to see what's happening. You know, whereas if you read it with a picture book, you know, there's a bit of interaction and you can use the pictures to explain things. Anyways, I found this one about Hebrews 11. And you remember in Hebrews 11, it says, you know, it talks about Rahab being, you know, through faith, she received the spies and sent them out another way. And one thing that the contemporary English version perverts about Rahab is it says that Rahab, who had been a prostitute, received the spies and sent them out another way. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says Rahab the harlot. So she was a harlot when she received them into the house because they went into a harlot's house. If she had been a harlot, then they're not going into a harlot's house anymore. She's not a harlot anymore. So it's just one thing, small things that they changed to try and promote this. Hey, you know, Rahab, you know, she was justified by works. She wasn't a harlot anymore, you know, when she got saved. But no, the Bible still refers to her as a harlot because I think it's making the point, like Jesus said, you know, the harlots and the publicans believed him, but the Pharisees didn't. They didn't, you know, believe on Jesus Christ like the harlots and publicans did. And it's not that the harlots and publicans ceased to be harlots and publicans. They were still harlots because you don't have to turn from your sin and give up your sin in order to be saved. You just have to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's just read Joshua 2, and we'll end on this passage. It says, "And Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, 'Go view the land, even Jericho.' And they went and came into an harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And was told the king of Jericho, saying, 'Behold, there came men in hither tonight to the children of Israel to search out the country.' And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, 'Bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country.' And the woman took the two men and hid them and said thus, 'There came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were.'" So she said, "I wist," so to know, right? I don't know where they were from. From whence is from where. From where they were. "And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Whither the men went, I wot not. Pursue after them quickly, for ye shall overtake them." So she's saying, like, well, they came to me, but at the shutting of the gate, they left. You know, I don't know where they came from, and I don't know where they are, but if you run after them quick, if you pursue them, you're going to catch them. So they quickly, you know, run off, and that's what it means. Like, she received the messages and sent them out another way. So she talked to these messengers from the king, but sent them out so that she could hide the spies. "But she had brought them up to the roof of the house and hid them with the stalks of flax which she had laid in order upon the roof. And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan unto the fords. And as soon as they were, as they which pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gate. So now there's not even a way for these messengers to come back, right? Because she's like sent them out of the city, and they go and run after them, and then the gates of the city close. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. So this has all happened really quickly, you can imagine. She's like, quick, like get up, right, and hide in the flax on the roof, because they didn't even like get under them yet. And then she's like, oh, hey, how you guys doing? They went that way. And she said unto the men, I know, this is what I want to focus on, and this is where I want to show you that even in the Old Testament passage of Rahab the harlot, it shows that she was saved before she did this deed. And she said unto the men, I know that the Lord hath given you the land. Right? So before they even come, she knows that they are coming and that they are coming because the Lord had sent them. And that your terror is fallen upon us and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. So it's not that these people, just because they don't have phones and internet in those days, that they don't get the message, right? Because just because you don't have phones and internet, there are other ways that they would get message out in those days. It's just that, you know, people don't need to take on those jobs anymore of being a post or being a messenger of just coming and just bringing news because we have email and things like that can do things electronically, that mostly people now just send parcels, or if they want to send a letter, just as, you know, something that is special as opposed to something that is necessary. And that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you. So not only did they hear about, you know, just them destroying the kings and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side, Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom he utterly destroyed. So they hear about them coming out and Moses actually being used to divide the Red Sea, walking across on dry land. But they also hear about, hey, what they did when they're about to come into the promised land. Because remember, they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years because the first time when they came out through the dry land, And the sea split, they sent in the 12 spies, if you remember. And 10 of them came back with an evil report, but Caleb and Joshua, they came back and said, hey, it's a seed in good land, God's given it to us. And because everyone believed the 10 spies, they had to wander in the wilderness for 40 years, and that generation died, except Caleb and Joshua. So then Joshua then leading the people into the promised land as they're coming in with Moses before they go in, they are killing, you know, these different kings that are standing in their way. And just before they go in, that's when Moses goes up to the mountain, he sees the promised land, he dies and God takes away his body. And then Joshua, being 40 years old, leads them into the promised land. And you know, one thing that's interesting, I know I was talking about Rahab, but I just got to share this with you just in case I don't tell you another time. You know, one thing that's interesting about Joshua is that Moses, when he came out of Egypt, when he left, he was 80 years old, right? But when he died, when Moses died, he was 120 years old, right? So that's the 40 years that they were in the wilderness. Remember, God said because he struck the rock twice, instead of speaking to the rock the second time, he wasn't allowed to go into the promised land. That's why God took him up to the mountain and he just saw it, but was not allowed to enter in. And then God buried his body somewhere. And that's, you know, we don't know where, nobody knows where Moses' body is, because he's going to be one of the two witnesses, most likely, that come back in the end times. But Joshua, when he goes into the promised land, was 40 years old. So that means that when they came out of Egypt, maybe he was just a baby in his mother's womb. And what I was thinking about there is, you know, Joshua, this great man of God, this great servant of Moses, he did these great things, he led the nation of Israel into the promised land. But imagine if Joshua's mom had an abortion. You know, what if she believed in a woman's right to choose? You know, we don't see like the value and the capability, what's the word I'm looking for? The capability, the potential, right? The potential of an individual that nobody even knew who Joshua was, possibly, when they came out of the promised land. But this man rose up, was a servant of Moses, and ended up being the next leader that was appointed after Moses passed away, and led this great army into the promised land. So that as a side note. But we see here that Rahab knew in verse 11, and as soon as we had heard these things, our heart did melt, Neither did there remain any more courage in any man. This is what gives the spies. So I'm like, man, they've delivered us because they've heard these things. They've heard what we've done to these kings. And Rahab is telling them, like, there's no man that even wants to go up against you, you know, to fight. Any more courage in any man because of you, For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Now, does that sound like an unbeliever? No, right? Because Rahab believed. She had heard the word of God, right? She had heard what that God did when they came out of Egypt. She had heard the word of God when they destroyed the kings, Og and Bashan, and the kings of the Amorites. And she believed God. She believed, and it was counted to her for righteousness. Now she's receiving. So because she believed, right? That's why she hid them, because she knew that God was going to deliver her nation into the hands of the Israelites. And because of her faith and because of what she did, right, she also got a blessing just like Abraham did. Because remember, Abraham believed, he became the father of many nations. She believed, and because of these works, she had her family saved. If you read on in the story how the scarlet thread representing the blood of Jesus Christ, and when they came in to Jericho after they marched around it 7 days and they blew the horn and the walls came down, they went in but saved Rahab alive and anybody that was in that house. So just showing that, hey, it didn't matter who was in Rahab's house, right? She could have had all her prostitute friends in that house, right, who were all unrepentant. Right? But as long as they were in that house, the scarlet thread, the blood of Jesus Christ, saved them from the wrath of God that was coming in to Jericho. So I hope you see here, I hope you learned something tonight, you know, so we can see that even Joshua 2 supports the view that Rahab believed God before she did the works, like we saw with Abraham, like we see it profiting other people when it talks, remember it talks about, you know, not just saying to people, be warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things that are needful to the body. So once you see all these things, I hope you start to see that when people say, oh, faith without works is dead, you don't flinch at that anymore and go, oh, how do I explain this? You know, listen to this sermon again, go over the scriptures, maybe write a little bookmark, so that you know, hey, I can show people, hey, Romans 4, I can note out those things that, hey, it's so obvious that James 2 is talking about your faith in the eyes of men, not in the eyes of God. You know, if Abraham were justified by works, he had to wear off to glory, but not before God. All right, I hope that sermon helps you. It definitely helped me to answer those questions. And if you didn't follow along or you missed it, make sure you go back and listen to this sermon so that we can be the most effective soul winners we can be. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. You know, Abraham is an example that is used throughout the New Testament. And I thank you, Lord, that you give us so much material about his life so that we can see that it's so clear, Lord, that salvation is not by works, that it's by grace through faith. Thank you, Lord, that it is by grace through faith, that we don't have to work for our salvation. Otherwise, Lord, I know that I would never make it. I'm a sinner. And Lord, I thank you for that. Thank you that Jesus died for us. And I pray, Lord, that that love would constrain us to preach the gospel, that it would drive us, Lord, on those days where it's too hot, it's too cold. Oh, Lord, on those days where we just don't feel like getting out of bed, Lord, you know, we're like mildly sick and we might use that as a reason not to go. And Lord, there's many reasons that we come up with, even the reasons that I try and come up with. Lord, I pray that this love would compel us to go out and preach the gospel. Lord, that we would get other people saved, but ultimately, Lord, that we would bring you glory because you're worthy. Thank you, Lord, for what you do for us. Help us to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And pray, Lord, that you would help this church to be a light and a blessing to all that are come in contact with it. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.